El 31 de enero de 1992, la NBC condujo una encuesta telefónica preguntándole a los ciudadanos americanos quién creían había asesinado al presidente John F. Kennedy. La NBC recibió 30.000 llamadas en 3 horas. El 51% dijo que la CIA lo hizo. En 1967, solo un hombre dijo que la CIA lo había hecho, Jim Garrison.
Lee Harvey Oswald killed no one at all. So the point is, it wasn't a question of being alone or with anybody. He had nothing to do with the assassination.
I had the impression, both before and after the assassination, that Jim Garrison was an absolute nut.
John Kennedy was killed by a major force. The simplest way to describe it is a Central Intelligence Agency. So many times that I stopped giving interviews. In other words, if the words ended up in print, they were twisted in an indescribable fashion. If they were for TV, repeatedly the editing resulted in an absurdity. So I reached the point in where I concluded it would be almost useless to try and communicate my position, and I was tired of being harassed.
Jim Garrison fue elegido en sus comienzos como fiscal de distrito de New Orleans el 3 de marzo de 1962. Garrison fue el primer fiscal de distrito independiente no alineado jamás elegido para ocupar ese cargo. Tenía 43 años, casi 4 años más joven que el presidente Kennedy. A diferencia de Kennedy, Garrison tenía poco dinero para su campaña, pero como Kennedy, tenía una carismática presencia en televisión. Fue ex piloto de combate, agente del FBI, asistente de fiscal, padre y marido. Cuando se hizo cargo como fiscal, comenzó a cancelar operaciones de juego y a cerrar burdeles. Sus acciones enfurecieron de tal modo a los jueces de estado que estos procedieron a cortar sus fondos para tales allanamientos. Garrison comenzó a criticar abiertamente las acciones de los que él llamaba las 8 vacas sagradas. Los 8 jueces estaban tan furiosos con sus comentarios que lo demandaron. En uno de sus fallos más famosos, la Suprema Corte le negó el derecho de criticar en público a los funcionarios. 5 años más tarde, Garrison lo haría nuevamente. Esta vez hablaría sobre el asesinato de Kennedy.
The case as it stood was a winnable case. It's a rather long story about how the government managed to tear it to pieces like a mad dog.
El 1 de marzo del 67, 5 años después de asumir, Jim Garrison asombró a América y especialmente a New Orleans cuando arrestó al prominente empresario Clay Shaw y lo acusó de conspiración en el asesinato de John F. Kennedy. Garrison acusó a Shaw de ser uno de los agentes de la CIA que cooperó para engañar a Lee Harvey Oswald y convertirlo en el títere del asesinato de John F. Kennedy.
He completely believed that his case would never get that his case would be stopped, that it would never get to trial, either because of his death or for some other reason.
If Garrison had succeeded in proving that Shaw was one of the ringleaders and that Shaw was connected with CIA, he would have pulled the plug on the conspiracy, which then immediately causes the public to drop the Oswald idea. If you've got a conspiracy, you've got more than one man up in a window with an old gun, and they would have stared in the face the great big letters, W-H-Y. Why was the president killed?
El presidente John F. Kennedy y la CIA.
I, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, do solemnly swear
that you will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
That I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
En enero de 1961, John F. Kennedy juró como el 35º presidente de los Estados Unidos ante el juez Earl Warren. John Kennedy heredó el cargo de presidente de Dwight D. Eisenhower. También heredó una política exterior que lo enfrentaría a las instituciones militares y a la CIA. América estaba en plena Guerra Fría. Desde que la nación estaba en paz, la Guerra Fría y las acciones militares eran conducidas por la CIA, cuyo director era Allen Dulles. Bajo el gobierno de Eisenhower, la CIA había tenido una exitosa y relativa mano libre para implementar la política exterior de la Guerra Fría americana.
In 1953, a few CIA people managed to make some changes in Iran that President Eisenhower liked very much. In 1954, a few of us in Guatemala made some changes that seemed almost without effort.
Cuando el presidente Kennedy asumió, fue forzado inmediatamente a confrontar y tomar decisiones sobre dos planes ya implementados por la CIA. Uno era Vietnam, donde Eisenhower ya había designado 15.000 profesionales militares como consejeros. La otra operación heredada del presidente era el plan de la CIA para derrocar a Castro.
First, I want to say that there will not be, under any conditions, be an intervention in Cuba by United States Armed Forces.
A pesar de la renuencia del nuevo presidente de invadir, la CIA convenció a Kennedy que si su brigada anti-Castro aterrizara en Bahía de los Cochinos, causaría inmediatamente un levantamiento popular que comenzaría con el derrocamiento de Castro. Bahía de los Cochinos fue un desastre.
Many of the participants in the Bay of Pigs were on that landing force because I had known them personally.
Algunos en la agencia culparon equivocadamente al presidente Kennedy por el fracaso, declarando que había fallado en proveer un adecuado soporte aéreo.
There were people in the agency who loved Jack Kennedy, but not in this particular Bay of Pigs sector. And that's where the rabid people are.
Detailed discussions are not to
El presidente, públicamente avergonzado por Bahía de los Cochinos, culpó a la agencia.
He fired Allen Dulles, longtime director of Central Intelligence, General Cabell as deputy, and it's interesting to recall that General Cabell was brother of the mayor of Dallas at the time President Kennedy was killed.
And John Kennedy's words when he fired him were roughly along these lines, that if this were England, I would have to go. But this is America, and you have to go. Well, General Cabell never forgave him for that, especially for causing the end of a brilliant intelligence career. And you can't help but feel that that's not totally irrelevant to the subsequent events when John Kennedy attempted to drive in an open car through the town where General Cabell's brother was mayor.
Un estudio presidencial de las actividades cubanas de la CIA obligó a Kennedy a intentar cercenar los poderes de la agencia.
The National Security Action Memorandum number 55, dated, I believe, in about early July of 61, and it began with this line. He said, "I hold the Joint Chiefs of Staff to be as responsible for advice to me in peacetime as they are for advice in wartime." Well, that positive statement just shook up the establishment because it meant that Kennedy was going to shatter the CIA in a thousand pieces.
Not the exclusive property of Republicans or Democrats.
El presidente también ordenó el regreso de los casi 15,000 consejeros de Vietnam.
This caused rising feelings among the industry. They felt that here's this enormous potential, and we're not going to realize it.
The gulf between Kennedy and the CIA has widened almost irreparably.
El creciente conflicto entre el presidente Kennedy y la CIA en cuanto a Vietnam fue reportado por Arthur Kroc en primera página del New York Times el 3 de octubre de 1963. Decía así: dos veces la CIA se negó terminantemente a ejecutar instrucciones del embajador Henry Cabot Lodge, traídas desde Washington, porque la agencia no estaba de acuerdo con ellas. El crecimiento de la CIA era semejante a una perversión donde el funcionario más alto creía no poder ser controlado ni por la Casa Blanca. Si los Estados Unidos alguna vez experimentan un golpe para derrocar el gobierno, vendrá desde la CIA. La agencia representa un tremendo poder y no rinde cuentas a nadie.
There was no need for anybody to inform Lyndon Johnson of the assassination because it was not necessary to burden them with the knowledge because it would be available for to serve the move into Southeast Asia in any case.
Dallas.
A larger part of the government bureaucracy, meaning key individuals here and there, were aware than the one would assume because there was too much of an overnight adjustment. The FBI was in full cooperation with the CIA and the perpetrators of the assassination within hours.
The president is running behind schedule. He pauses momentarily to shake a few hands.
El 22 de noviembre de 1963, el presidente Kennedy y su esposa Jacqueline arribaron a Love Field, Dallas, Texas. La multitud mostraba sobrecogedores signos de afecto. También había pancartas. Cientos de panfletos distribuidos a lo largo de la ruta de la caravana acusaban al presidente Kennedy de actividades desleales contra los Estados Unidos, de traicionar la Constitución y de dejar la soberanía de los Estados Unidos en manos de las Naciones Unidas, controladas por el comunismo. Una nota completa del Dallas Morning News de ese día daba sarcásticamente la bienvenida al señor Kennedy, no al presidente Kennedy, preguntando, entre otras cosas, por qué América Latina se estaba tornando antiamericana o comunista. La seguridad alrededor de la caravana de Dallas era sorprendentemente pobre, considerando las conocidas amenazas contra la vida del presidente. Solo días antes, una caravana había sido cancelada en Miami a causa de estas amenazas. El 9 de noviembre, la policía de Miami había descubierto un plan para asesinar al presidente con rifles de alto poder. El FBI y el informante para la policía, Willie Somerset, grabó secretamente una conversación con Miltier, un extremista de derecha, en la cual este reveló el plan. Interrogado por el FBI, Miltier negó haber hecho tales amenazas y fue liberado, pero la policía de Miami canceló la caravana. El 17 de noviembre, un cable del FBI fue enviado a todos los agentes especiales a cargo. Decía así: una amenaza de asesinato contra el presidente Kennedy, Dallas, 22-23 de noviembre. El 22 de noviembre, el presidente Bush, entonces un respetable empresario, había informado que James Parrott había estado hablando de matar al presidente cuando viniera a Houston.
The assassination would not have been attempted without assurance that certain members of the Dallas police force were going to cooperate. I think it's fair to describe the assassination as essentially a no-risk operation.
A couple hours before Kennedy was to arrive, the sheriff called us in, what I call the street people, the plainclothesmen, the detectives, and he instructed us that we were to stand out in front and in no way take part in the security of that motorcade. That we were merely spectators and nothing more.
A military unit that has had, in addition to its ordinary duties, a training for what we call presidential protection. They need an order from the Secret Service. In the case of Dallas, the colonel was led to believe that his unit wasn't needed, that another one would be there. Everything was all right. It won't be needed.
As late as Thursday, November 21st, the newspapers in Dallas showed the route of the motorcade as it came out Main, continuing through the extension of Maine going in the middle of that big pasture they call Dealey Plaza. On Thursday evening, at the 11th hour, the route was changed by the administration of Mayor Earl Cabell. The route was changed to turn right on Houston and then left on Elm, not only going by the ambush nest where the waiting rifles were, but also going by the building in which they had pre-located the Patsy. Indications are three teams at the minimum, with two teams shooting from the grassy knoll, that's four men, and at least one team in the back, although not on the sixth floor at that window. They could not have been going any faster as they passed the depositor, as they passed through the target zone of 11 or 12 miles an hour, which is virtually stationary if you have rifles and professionals waiting for you.
It appears as though something has happened in the motorcade route. Something, I repeat, has happened in the motorcade route. There's numerous people running up the hill alongside Elm Street. Stand by just a moment, please. Put me on, Phil, put me on. The motorcade is coming by here. The presidential car coming up now. We know it's the presidential car. You see Mrs. Kennedy's pink suit. There's a Secret Service man, spread eagle, over the top of the car. We understand Governor and Mrs. Connolly are in the car with President and Mrs. Kennedy. We can't see who has been hit, if anybody's been hit, but apparently something is wrong here. Something is terribly wrong.
En el hospital Parkland, el personal intentó todo procedimiento conocido para salvarle la vida. El doctor Perry insertó un tubo hacia la tráquea por el orificio de la bala en la garganta. El doctor Robert McClellan fue el médico más cercano a la herida en el cráneo del presidente.
The wound was in the back part of the head, and just about where I'm indicating here, and was probably involved an area about that big around, and perhaps larger, but certainly no smaller than that. And a portion of the brain fell out onto the cart. Mrs. Kennedy behaved very admirably, I think. She certainly was in a state of shock, as would be expected. She was carrying a portion of his brain in one of her hands and gave it to one of the physicians. She was obviously much more comfortable staying inside, and stayed there, in fact, until a priest arrived to administer the last rites.
He died of a gunshot wound in the brain, of a bullet right through the head.
John Kennedy was obviously shot from the front. Everybody knows it. Virtually everybody in Dealey Plaza rushed to the grassy knoll, where they heard the sounds.
It came from a fence between the book depository and the railroad track.
From behind the overpass over there, a triple overpass.
Right over about 20 or 30 feet from the other end of that little picket fence.
And it sounded like it came from the left and in front of us, towards the wooden fence. And there was a puff of smoke that came underneath the trees.
We all three four seen about the same thing as the shot. The smoke came from behind the hedge.
And then as the cart got directly in front of us with a gunshot apparently from behind us, hit the president in the side of the temple.
Do you think the first gunshot came from behind you too?
I think it came from the same location, apparently back up on the mall.
When I stated I felt like the second and third shots could not have been fired from the same rifle, they reminded me that I wasn't an expert.
There was three or four real close together, and it was must have been the first one that shot him, because that's when I took the picture. And during that time, after I took the picture, and the shots were still being fired, as I decided I better get on the ground. I was no more than 15 foot from the car and in line of fire, evidently.
Just as Mary started to take the picture and the president came right even with us,
two shots. We looked at him, and he was looking at a dog in the middle of the seat. Two shots rang out, and he grabbed his chest and a look of pain on his face and fell across toward Jackie, and she fell over on him and said, "My God, he's shot." And there was an interval, and then three or four more shots rang out, but that time the motorcade had sped away.
In the vicinity of the two men, there was a flash of light, there was something which occurred which caught my eye in this immediate area on the embankment.
Ed Hoffman, un sordo mudo parado junto al puente del ferrocarril, tuvo una vista clara detrás de la blanca cerca de pinches.
A cigarette. He was smoking a cigarette. And then a little bit later, he saw more smoke, and he saw the man turn around, and he had a gun in his hand, or a rifle. Saw him turn. He turned towards the area where he was standing, and he saw him run and throw the gun to a man that was wearing a railroad uniform. And the man took the gun apart and put it in a bag behind the railroad controls, the box there. And then he was frightened. He knew something was going on. And he started waving for a police officer. He saw a security guard or a Secret Service. He wasn't sure what he was, but he was trying to get his attention and tell him what he had saw. And the man turned his gun towards him, and it frightened my father, so he left.
Otros testigos oyeron disparos desde atrás. Fotografías tomadas inmediatamente después del asesinato mostraron un hombre en ropa común levantando una bala. Otras mostraron un fuego de rebote en la vereda, disparado desde el depósito de libros. James Staggs, de pie junto al triple paso inferior frente a la limusina, enfrentando al depósito, fue golpeado por una bala o un trozo de concreto. Un orificio de bala fue encontrado en el tablero de la limusina presidencial. Había una cachadura en el parabrisas. El oficial motociclista Billy Hargis, conduciendo a la izquierda y atrás de la limusina presidencial, había sido salpicado por la sangre y tejido cerebral del presidente. Otro fotógrafo tomó a Jack Roby en la escena del asesinato. Hubo más de 20 arrestos inmediatamente después del asesinato. Solo tres fueron documentados.
Eugene Hale Brading, the high-level courier for the mafia, who was arrested at the scene under the name of Jim Braden and interviewed by the FBI, then turned loose.
Attention all squad. Attention all squad. The suspect in the shooting at Elm in Houston is reported to be an unknown white male, approximately 30.
A las 12:45 p.m., 15 minutos después de los disparos al presidente, la policía difundió la descripción del sospechoso basados en una pista. A la 1:15, el oficial de policía de Dallas, J.D. Tippett, fue asesinado cerca de la esquina de la 10 y Platon. Poco después de la 1, la policía recibió el llamado de un joven respondiendo a la descripción del asesino del oficial Tippett, desconocido hombre blanco de unos 30 años que había entrado al teatro de Texas sin comprar entrada.
That's the only report that the police got before they sent 15 cars to surround the Texas theater. And even though the Dallas police have an admirable concern for the protection of property, they usually would have held back a few police cars in reserve, even for a type of criminal who would go into a theater without a ticket.
También en la escena del arresto de un hombre blanco de aproximadamente 30 años, además de 15 patrullas, estuvieron el asistente del fiscal de distrito y un ejército de periodistas.
Without knowing precisely who they were, I think there had to be assurance that there would be, at least at the outset, a few elements of the media that would be cooperative from the beginning, because they had to start off with a certain momentum from the beginning before reality started to interfere with the building of the illusion.
A la 1:50, una hora y 20 minutos después de hechos los disparos al presidente, Lee Harvey Oswald fue arrestado solo por el asesinato del oficial J.D. Tippett. Cuando fue llevado en custodia y registrado, tenía dos identificaciones diferentes. Una era por Lee Harvey Oswald, la otra por Alex James Heddle. No admitió ser ninguno de los dos.
Well, name is Lee Harvey Oswald, O-S-W-A-L-D.
I really don't know what the situation is about. Nobody has told me anything. Except that I'm accused of murdering a policeman. I know nothing more than that, and I do request for someone to come forward to give me a legal assistance.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about it was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
El oficial a cargo de la investigación de la muerte de Tippit fue el detective retirado James Lebel, que fue uno de los primeros en interrogar a Oswald.
His demeanor was awfully calm. I know that I could not have answered the questions in the same manner that he did had I actually been guilty of killing two people.
Did you kill the president?
No, I've not been charged with that. In fact, nobody has said that to me yet. The first thing I heard about was when the newspaper reporters in the hall asked me that question.
You have been.
Lee Oswald, who's been rewarded for his work in Russia, in the government's behalf, by being given training as an expert photographer. When they arrested him, he had over $3,000 worth of camera equipment, so he was no ordinary photographer.
According to Dallas Police Captain Will Fritz's own notes, he showed the famous backyard photograph to Oswald during the 12 hours of interrogation, and Oswald said, "It's a fake, and I can prove it, and I will prove it in time."
Poco después del arresto de Oswald, la policía de Dallas encontró dos fotografías de Oswald posando orgullosamente en el fondo de su casa con dos periódicos comunistas, un rifle y una pistola. Stephen Jaffe, un analista de fotografía e investigador de Jim Garrison, le confirmó a Garrison lo que Oswald no vivió para probar él mismo.
Whoever framed Oswald evidently used only one picture of his face and planted it on someone else's body. Then to give the face on the right a different look, it seems they airbrushed some of the facial features and tilted the head slightly. And in doing so, they tilted the shadow under his nose. That it was one face is easily demonstrated. If you take the face on the right and superimpose it over the face on the left, the features line up. But when you slide the face back, you see that it had to be tilted. The second and more obvious proof is with the position of the bodies. The body on the right seems to be closer to the camera. If so, the head should be larger. However, you can see when you slide it over the face on the left, the faces are the same size. This means the bodies should be the same height. They are not.
Las noticias sobre el arresto de Oswald corrieron por el mundo inmediatamente. Fletcher Prouty estaba en Nueva Zelanda.
About noontime, we bought the paper. One thing I noticed clearly was the New Zealand paper had a full biographical story of this Lee Harvey Oswald. Well, on that day, he was in a T-shirt or a polo shirt, but certainly not a business suit. Now, this was on the 23rd of November there, and I understand the time differences and all that. You couldn't gather that much information on a relatively random 24-year-old boy. Somebody had written the story about Oswald before he ever shot the president. Just had to be.
Oswald, in the late fall of 62, and a little bit in 63, had lived at 602 Elizabeth, okay? But that address never showed up on any of his applications or employment forms for the book depository. Colonel Jones with 4th Army Military Intelligence got a call from his people in Dallas, and they said they've got a suspect here, and his name is Alex J. Heidel. And Jones said he went to military intelligence files and looked up Alex J. Heidel and found it cross-referenced to Lee Harvey Oswald, and it gave his address as 605 Elsbeth. And what does all that mean? Army intelligence tipped off the Dallas police that the man they wanted was Lee Harvey Oswald.
Justo antes del arresto de Oswald, se hallaron en el sexto piso del depósito de libros de la Escuela Texas dos rifles diferentes. El agente de policía Robert Gray y C. Moore Weissman habían descubierto un Mauser 7.65.
We weren't any more than 6 or 8 inches from the rifle, and stamped right on the barrel of the rifle was 7.65 Mauser.
El otro rifle encontrado fue un Mannlicher Carcano 6.5. Fue rastreado hasta un apartado postal a nombre de A.J. Hiddell, el alias de Oswald. Cuando esta arma ligada a Oswald fue hallada, el Mauser desapareció. Roger Craig también fue el primer policía en encontrar casquillos usados por el Mannlicher Carcano, el rifle de Oswald, los cuales, según él, habían caído de manera muy extraña después de los disparos.
Deputy Sheriff Luke Mooney was with me when we found the shells. We found three holes beside the window on the sixth floor. They were lying three in a row, not more than an inch apart, all pointing in the same direction.
And the paraffin test would show whether or not you fired a rifle. The results were available before the end of the day. They showed that Oswald had not fired a rifle. But the way that that was handled was it was announced to the world that the paraffin test showed that he had fired a rifle.
Chief, we understand you have the results of the paraffin test which were made to determine whether Oswald had fired a weapon. Can you tell us what those tests showed?
I understand that it was positive.
The fingerprints on the boxes added up to the fingerprints of a large number of policemen, one unidentified man, and no fingerprints of Lee Oswald.
If we can put his prints on the rifle, I certainly would connect him with a rifle.
Inmediatamente después del arresto de Oswald, aunque el FBI no tenía jurisdicción legal, J. Edgar Hoover actuó rápidamente para hacerse cargo del caso.
In fact, I have a record in which Hoover said that even though he had no jurisdiction, he started the investigation before being told to.
It never dawned on us until the last minute that they were going to take over the whole investigation. Same thing when they took the body away. They violated the laws of the state of Texas, and they had no jurisdiction over it.
We in the police department here did not know he was in Dallas. I understand the FBI did know that he was in Dallas.
The first law is cover the bureau's ass, and the second is cover your own.
This has been a joint effort by the Secret Service, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, the Dallas Police Department.
El testigo clave del asesinato de Tippit no identificó a Oswald como el asesino. El periodista Jim Mars dijo que esto condujo a procedimientos cuestionables de la policía.
Late in the evening of the day of the assassination, and everybody in the country had heard of the name Lee Harvey Oswald, and that the shots had come from the Texas School Book Depository. So can you imagine how fair the lineup was when Oswald has to step forward and say, I'm Lee Harvey Oswald, I work at the Texas School Book Depository. Would it have been hard to pick him out of that one? Not a chance. The lineups were a farce.
We try to make it look as authentic as, make them look alike as much as possible. Same height, same weight, and so forth. Now, in Scoggins, he said that him mouthing and raising hell, he did. He didn't raise all that. He did complain because he said, I got a T-shirt on and the rest of them got shirts on.
Well, nothing more than that. I do request for someone to come forward to give me a legal assistance.
How do you sum him up as a man based on your experience with criminal types?
I think he's a man that planned this murder weeks or months ago and has laid his plans carefully and carried them out and has planned at that time what he's going to tell the police.
I emphatically deny these charges.
He would have been acquitted in any courtroom in the world.
Oswald fue interrogado por el FBI y por la policía de Dallas durante 12 horas. No se hizo ninguna transcripción formal o grabación. El capitán Wilfred dijo que la habitación era demasiado pequeña para acomodar a un estenógrafo. Un memo secreto del FBI reveló que Hoover había ordenado al consejo convencer al público de que Oswald era el verdadero asesino y de encubrir la investigación.
Oswald was not involved in any way. As a matter of fact, he was standing on the first floor watching the parade.
Cuando se hicieron los primeros disparos al presidente, el fotógrafo de Associated Press, J. Atkins, tomó esta fotografía. En segundo plano, de pie en la entrada del depósito, había alguien parecido a Oswald. El FBI, luego de lo que ellos consideraron un cuidadoso análisis de las fotos del arresto de Oswald y de su camisa, dijo que aquel hombre de la entrada era otra persona llamada Billy Lovelady. Charles Bronson filmó esto en el momento del asesinato. Lo entregó al FBI porque decía que mostraba al depósito de libros en el momento de los disparos. El FBI analizó la película e informó que no mostraba el edificio de donde provinieron los disparos y que no era suficientemente clara para su identificación.
It's not possible to look at something for 5 seconds if you're paying any attention and not recognizing a building, especially the most notorious building in the world at that time. Even worse, not sufficiently clear for identification purposes means no Oswald with a smoking gun. If it didn't have Oswald with a smoking gun, the FBI didn't want any pictures.
La filmación más famosa del asesinato es la de Abraham Zapruder. Uno de los documentos más asombrosos del FBI es el que rechaza esta película, porque no tiene validez alguna como evidencia. La película Zapruder sería inaccesible al público hasta que Garrison iniciara una demanda en su juicio a Clay Shaw. Aunque el público fue privado de ver la película, había oído mucho sobre ella.
2 days after the assassination of President Kennedy, the bidding started on the Zapruder film in Abraham Zapruder's living room. Richard Stolle was bidding for Life magazine, and Dan Rather was bidding for CBS TV. CBS authorized him to go up as high as $10,000, and he bid the $10,000, and by the time Zapruder finished laughing, Rather grabbed his coat, ran out of there, ran down to CBS, and out of breath, on the air, starts saying, I've just seen the film of the assassination of President Kennedy. And he goes through this whole story and he starts recalling what went on. He says, and as the president is struck in the head, he's thrown violently forward. Violently forward? No matter where you think the shots came from, I know of no person who has seen the Zapruder film at any time through the years who doesn't have the immediate impression that the most obvious thing outside of the explosion of the head is the fact that the president is thrown to the rear.
Oswald has hustled through a doorway.
En una conferencia de prensa la noche del asesinato, el fiscal de distrito Wade dijo a los reporteros que Oswald era un miembro de la Libre Comisión Cubana. El dueño de un club nocturno, Jack Robey, corrigió a Wade señalando que se llamaba Justicia para la Comisión Cubana.
The FBI was in full cooperation with the CIA, and the perpetrators of the assassination within hours. Julia Ann Mercer on Saturday, the day after the assassination, is telling the FBI about how she saw Jack Ruby unload a young man with a rifle on the grassy knoll. By the next day, they had a photograph of one of the participants in the assassination. An additional day of freedom was allowed him, which would not have been allowed you. Not allowed me. We would have been picked up within minutes for questioning. Right now, within minutes. He was never arrested until after he'd eliminated the patsy.
He's been shot.
Mass confusion.
Gordon Shanklin, agente a cargo de la oficina Dallas del FBI, testificó haber advertido a la policía de Dallas acerca de una llamada anónima amenazando matar a Oswald.
Came into the clerk that was operating the switchboard. The same call I later found out are the same, probably the same individual, called the sheriff's office.
He called Billy Grammer the night before and warned him that they had to change their plans because we're going to kill him. Another anonymous caller, probably again Jack Ruby, called the FBI, warned them too. So there was advance warnings that they better do something. Ruby didn't want to do this. He had been ordered to silence Oswald.
He figured we'd arrest him, put him in jail, and he'd have to go before the grand jury, and the grand jury say, Jack, this is a bad thing that you've done, but since Oswald needed killing, well, we're going to let you go this time, but don't do it again.
Ruby was one of those contract employees, is the way to describe him. He was not an agent. By the time he had finished doing some of the things that depended on him, like unloading the rifle with grass and all, he'd also placed himself in a position where they had found another chore for him to do. I said it was a shock to him, but it would have been, I suggest, it would have been presented to him along these lines. Well, Jack, baby, don't say no. I mean, After all, you did participate in the assassination of the president.
Instead of throwing Oswald in the car that was already sitting there ready to go and rushing him to the hospital, they dragged him back into the jail office. They called for an ambulance, which showed up 6 or 7 minutes later.
Parkland furnishes the city with this intern on Saturdays and Sundays, and that's part of his training. And so we knew he was there. He was only 40, 50 feet away. And he was summoned over there, and he did a quick examination and started some kind of respiratory work on him.
Now, anyone with any sense, any knowledge of medicine, knows that when somebody's gut shot or bleeding internally, you don't pump up and down on it. Oswald gave out with a moan and just kind of collapsed, and Oswald was dead before he ever even got to the hospital.
Lee Harvey Oswald killed no one at all. So the point is, it wasn't a question of being alone or with anybody. He had nothing to do with the assassination. To answer it more fully, one of the functions of the Warren Commission was to conceal the fact that Lee Oswald was not involved, was to conceal the fact that he was not involved in any way, and to make it appear as if he were involved. And they've been very successful so far in that objective.
La Comisión Warren.
This is a sad time for all people. We have suffered a loss that cannot be waived. For me, it is a deep personal tragedy. I know that the world shares the sorrow that Mrs. Kennedy and her family bear.
Down this avenue of sadness, they bring President John F. Kennedy, martyred hero, to lie in state under the great dome of the Capitol. Mrs. Kennedy comes forward with Caroline in a tableau that calls for no words. Its poignancy calls only for tears.
El presidente John F. Kennedy murió el 22 de noviembre de 1963. También su política exterior.
President Johnson represents a sorrowing people.
They had Johnson there, too, his successor to be, in the situation where he had to hear the gunfire. And he heard the gunfire. And that is apparent by the fact that he changed the foreign policy of the United States in regard to Asia within 72 hours. As a matter of fact, he changed it on the following Sunday after the eulogy, after attending the eulogy in Washington. He met with the chiefs of staff, and in effect, his message was, tell them in Vietnam that everything's changed 180 degrees. We're going to back them all the way.
An eternal flame is lighted before the grave by Mrs. Kennedy, the first such memorial to burn in Arlington Cemetery. She is followed by the president's brothers, Robert and Edward.
Bobby was so devastated by his brother's death, he kind of took a view, what difference does anything make? He's dead.
Con la muerte de Oswald, se aceleraron las preguntas acerca del asesinato de Kennedy. El Congreso demandó una investigación, pero esta fue cancelada por un memorándum del asistente del fiscal general, Nicholas Katzenbach, enviado a la Casa Blanca, sugiriendo una comisión presidencial. Una investigación por separado del estado de Texas también fue detenida por este memorándum.
That the public must be satisfied that Oswald was the assassin. It's before the first witness was questioned. There was no investigation. But the public must be satisfied that Oswald was the assassin. He doesn't even say that Oswald was. Just that the public has to be satisfied that he did not have Confederates who are still at large.
El asistente del fiscal general sintió que Texas no era el lugar para realizar una investigación.
Another investigation in Texas, which I thought was a terrible idea, because I had absolutely no confidence that the attorney general would have the cooperation that one had to have. He didn't have the resources of the Bureau, of the CIA. And I also thought, with Lyndon Johnson coming from Texas, that was the worst possible. person to investigate. Everybody would think that was totally under Lyndon Johnson's control.
Katzenbach estaba preocupado porque algunas personas podían pensar que el presidente Johnson había hecho matar a Kennedy. Fletcher Prouty dijo haber visto un memo personal de Hoover respondiendo satisfactoriamente a la pregunta de si Johnson estaba involucrado o no.
Hoover had lived across the street from Johnson for 19 years here in Washington. They were old buddies. They borrowed each other's lawnmower. You know, they were old friends. They weren't just president and head of the FBI. Johnson said, you're sure you have the man that did it? He said, oh, yes. He said, Oswald. He's up there in a, he said, fifth floor of the building. He missed by a floor, but that's, we'll give him credit for that. And then Johnson said, were any of them fired at me? I think that clears up the question of whether Johnson was involved. If he thought they were shooting at him, he didn't hire the gunner.
You always had the fear that this could be some kind of conspiracy involving the Soviet Union. And that was such a horrible thing to try to think of. If they could miscalculate in that kind of a way, doomsday was pretty darn close.
El presidente Johnson informó al jefe de justicia Warren que la CIA le había enviado información explosiva desde las oficinas de la Ciudad de México. Las oficinas estaban encabezadas por David Adler Phillips. El presidente dijo que la CIA tenía grabaciones y films de Oswald conversando con un agente ruso dos meses antes del asesinato de Kennedy. Y solo un hombre como Warren podría evitar el día D.
So, after the meeting, after Bob initially saying no 30 times, Chief Justice Warren comes out of the Oval Room with tears running down his face, and for reasons which I think are probably essentially altruistic, has regarded to head an investigation in which he knows the result has to be, in one way or another, has to be false.
7 días después del asesinato de Kennedy, se estableció la Comisión Warren. Uno de los primeros citados por el presidente Johnson fue Allen W. Dulles, ex director de la CIA, despedido por el presidente Kennedy, luego de Bahía de los Cochinos.
Katzenbach had his way. There were no public hearings. There were hearings behind closed doors. This is the most amazing thing. If today, someone, or even at that time, someone wanted, some judge said, this is a story about an abused child who was sexually abused or some other salacious rape case or something, I don't want this to be public, the ACLU would be knocking on the federal courthouse with an injunction on behalf of CBS, the New York Times, the Washington Post, we have a right to know, etc. This is the investigation, hearings into the death of the President of the United States. There was not an editorial in the New York Times or the Washington Post or any other newspaper in America for 9 months as the hearings went on, saying, open the door, let the American people in.
En la primera sesión de la comisión, trataron las noticias reveladas por el asistente del fiscal del distrito, Bill Alexander, y publicadas en el Houston Post, que Oswald era un informante para el FBI. En la agenda de Oswald estaban los datos del agente James Hostey del FBI. La página con el número telefónico de Hostey había sido arrancada cuando el FBI la entregó a la comisión. Esta le preguntó a Hoover si Oswald era un informante para el consejo. Hoover dijo no. La comisión aceptó la palabra del director.
Something has happened in the motorcade route. Something, I repeat, has happened in the motorcade route. There's numerous people running up the hill alongside Elm Street. Stand by just a moment, please. Put me on, Phil. Put me on.
La Comisión Warren y su plantel tenía dos problemas que resolver. Uno era que el presidente había sido asesinado por un disparo en la cabeza. Rayos X y fotografías de las heridas estaban a disposición de la comisión. Esta prefirió ver los dibujos.
Do you have no description of that head wound which is fatal in the 5 volumes of the FBI report? Cows will jump over the moon before you'll find it in the Warren report.
Este documento del FBI muestra que dos agentes estuvieron presentes en todo momento durante la autopsia de Kennedy, a los que se les ofreció las radiografías y fotografías que el FBI rechazó.
Can you imagine anything more important than trying to solve a crime? Then the autopsy?
The handling of the autopsy by the government indicates deception from the outset. The burning of the notes by Commander Humes.
He burned it in the fireplace. No questions were asked.
The word was given clearly to Commander Humes of the results they wanted. And one of the results they had to obtain for the government position to stand up was that the shot came from the back.
Docenas de testigos oculares que dijeron que al presidente le dispararon desde el frente fueron ignorados o fastidiados. Jack Ruby dijo a Earl Warren y General Ford que deseaba decir la verdad y pidió ser llevado a Washington porque temía por su vida en Dallas. Su oferta de hablar fue rechazada.
The world will never know the true facts of what occurred, my motives. The people that have so much to gain and have such a material motive for putting me in a position I'm in will never let the true facts come of their voice to the world.
Now, these people are in very high positions, Jack.
Aún en su lecho de muerte, Lee Harvey Oswald fue privado de un abogado. Mark Lane fue uno de los directores de la campaña Kennedy en Nueva York en 1960. Choqueado por el burdo manejo que se hacía con Oswald y por las pruebas ofrecidas por las autoridades de Dallas, Lane viajó a Texas e interrogó a testigos y peritos y escribió un artículo sobre lo averiguado.
I called Carrie McWilliams, who was the editor of Nation magazine, and I said, Carrie, I have something now I want you to publish. He said, great. About the housing problem? About drug addiction? I said, no. About the Kennedy assassination? Don't bring it over. I don't want to look at it. I said, I'd just like you to look. Don't look. Don't, no. Don't bring it over. And he hung up. And that was the response I got throughout the United States. I went to see Jimmy Wexler, good friend of mine, editor of the New York Post. And he said, don't publish it. I said, well, the National Guardian said they would publish. He said, no, don't. No, don't publish it anywhere. You can't get it published in any respectable publication. Don't give it to them. I said, what should I do, burn it? He said, yes. So I took it to the National Guardian. They published it. It was an editorial in the New York Post by Jimmy Wexler, my friend, which said, why did he take it there when anyone in America would have published it? Why did he start on the left?
La madre de Oswald vio el artículo y pidió a Mark representar a su hijo fallecido.
All I want to do is write an article. That's all I wanted 28 years ago, was to write this one article about the matter, and I thought that that would be relieving of my responsibility, but I met with her. And she said, I read your article. Will you go before the Warren Commission and see to it that he gets a fair shake? And I said, yes. And I said, but listen, you can't really be my client, because if I find out that he did it, I want to feel free to say that. She said, do it. I'll write it down. He didn't do it. He worked for American intelligence. They sent him to do various things, but he would not kill the president. He would never do that. And so she signed a document saying I could conduct my own investigation and I could reveal whatever it is I want to reveal.
Mark Lane fue en principio invitado por la comisión para servir como consejero de Oswald. Luego cambió de opinión.
They called me as a witness. I guess because they found out I wasn't in Dealey Plaza on November 22nd, 1963, therefore I was eligible to testify. The four of them. And what they were trying to do was to get me to tell them everything that I knew. And I said, but I'm here as a lawyer, not as a witness. I wasn't there. I can tell you what people said, but I want to present witnesses. They said no.
I am convinced beyond any question of a doubt that the first shot that was fired did not hit me. Then I was hit.
La posición del gobierno era que Lee Harvey Oswald disparó solo tres balas en 5.6 segundos desde el sexto piso del depósito. Según estos esquemas de la comisión, una de las balas dio al presidente en el cráneo, otra falló y dio a James Stagg, de pie bajo el triple pasaje. Esto significa que para sostener la posición del gobierno del triple disparo, una bala tendría que haber atravesado tanto a Kennedy como al gobernador John Connally. Esta bala, que balísticamente combinaba con el Mannlicher Carcano de Oswald, fue encontrada accidentalmente en una camilla del hospital Parklands.
You might have among the shooters some individuals who were unsophisticated in their other talents and limited, say, to shooting, which appears to be the case. But in Jack Ruby, they had the triple hat man, and one of the functions I'm satisfied was dropping that pristine bullet, number 399, if I recall, under the right stretcher.
Si un disparo falló y el otro dio en el cráneo del presidente, entonces esta bala mágica debería haber causado la herida en el cuello del presidente y todas las heridas del gobernador Connally. Garrison dijo que para probar esta teoría elaborada por Allen Spector, la comisión realizó algunos de sus dibujos más creativos. Este es un esquema de la comisión que muestra cómo, según el gobierno, la prueba 399 hizo todo el daño. La bala, según ellos, atravesó el cuello del presidente sin tocar el hueso. Se desvió. Luego entró por la espalda de Connally, destrozando 4 pulgadas de su quinta costilla. Salió por debajo de su tetilla derecha. Se desvió hacia abajo, demolió los huesos grandes de su muñeca derecha. Se desvió hacia la izquierda, ubicándose en su muslo izquierdo. Allí se quedó hasta que llegó al hospital Parkland, donde cayó sobre una camilla intacta.
U.S. Chief Justice Earl Warren is the bearer of the sad epilogue. The report of the assassination of President John Fitzgerald Kennedy.
9 meses después del comienzo de las audiencias, se publicó el informe Warren probando la culpabilidad de Oswald. Garrison dijo que la comisión pudo haber ahorrado el dinero de los contribuyentes porque la revista Life ya había llegado a esa conclusión 8 meses y medio antes, cuando publicaron una foto de tapa de Oswald posando con las armas que había utilizado para matar al presidente y al oficial Tippett.
The head of CBS, Bill Paley, had been involved with the CIA from the time that it was the OSS. He'd always been a loyalist to him. And CBS invested their own credibility in this at the very, very beginning. At the moment of the release of the report, they were in the middle of a 2-hour special backing the report before it had ever been released. They had produced it, they had it ready, they had the interviews done.
And they took him down to Dealey Plaza and they said, okay, Mr. Nix, where did the shots come from? Where did you hear the shots come from?
From a fence between the book depository and the railroad track.
Cut, cut, cut. Now, Mr. Nix, where did you hear the shots come from?
It came from a fence.
Cut, cut, cut. They finally pulled him aside, this man did, and pulled him aside and said, now, Mr. Nix, what did the Warren Commission say? Where did they say these shots came from?
From the book depository.
And they said, that's right, and that's what we want you to say. And I remember riding home with him. He was so upset. I mean, he would hit the driving wheel, the steering wheel, and say, why? I mean, they try and make me look like I'm insane. And I know that's where they came from. I know that's where the shots came from.
To publish the report. As Alan Dulles said, one of the top people running the investigation, the American people don't read. But as it turned out, some of us do.
New Orleans.
Full name is Lee Harvey Oswald, O-S-W-A-L-D.
We had learned within days that Oswald spent the summer in New Orleans. I was still district attorney. So that meant I might have an obligation to look into him because I should find out what he was doing in New Orleans.
En New Orleans, Garrison descubrió que Oswald había sido arrestado por repartir panfletos de justicia para Cuba. Luego apareció en televisión hablando sobre su filosofía marxista.
These then are the differences between an outright communist country and countries which adhere to leftist and Marxist principles.
In your work with the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, what are you advocating?
Oswald, un supuesto simpatizante de Castro, trabajó para Guy Bannister, uno de los más fanáticos anticomunistas de New Orleans, detective privado y ex jefe de consejo de Chicago del FBI. También fue visto en esa oficina con David Ferry, otro fanático anticomunista y piloto de la CIA. Un empleado de Bannister dijo confidencialmente a Garrison que Ferry dejó su casa la tarde después del asesinato para conducir hasta Houston y luego Galveston. Interrogado por Garrison en 1963, Ferry negó conocer a Oswald y dijo que había ido a Houston a patinar. Garrison entregó a Ferry al FBI, que lo liberó con una disculpa. Por los próximos 3 años, Garrison se olvidó de Ferry. Durante ese periodo jamás se le ocurrió poner en duda las conclusiones del informe Warren, hasta que tuvo una conversación ocasional con el senador Long, en la que éste le expresó sus dudas acerca de la integridad del informe.
I recall my reply almost exactly. I think I said something in a state of surprise that, are you suggesting that there really was something more to it, that there might be a cover-up by the government? And his words were along the line of, well, that's a mild way to put it.
Esta conversación ocasional con el senador Long condujo a uno de los más espectaculares juicios en la historia de New Orleans. Todo comenzó el día que Garrison ordenó 3 copias del informe Warren, de 26 volúmenes, y comenzó a leer.
We had a copy in the car, we had a copy in the office, and at his home. And I'd pick him up in the morning, you know, his volume with him, read it in the automobile, in the office, at night taking him home, you know, weekends and Sundays and holidays, that's all he did. And I'll say this, he just about knew that 26 volume verbatim.
To show you how cosmically irrelevant the Warren Report is, for the most part, to hide those little rare pieces of relevance. One of the exhibits is classified in the front as a study of the teeth of Jack Ruby's mother. Even if Jack Ruby had intended to bite Oswald to death, that still would not have been relevant.
En el informe Warren, Garrison descubrió que el fiscal por New Orleans fue contactado el 23 de noviembre para representar a Oswald. Garrison luego supo que esta llamada a Dean Andrews vino de un tal Clay Bertrand y que no era la primera vez que éste estaría ayudando a Oswald.
Dean Andrews was being visited by Lee Oswald with regard to some legal problems he had with his wife, Marina, and we found that a man who used the name Clay Bertrand was making the payments.
Informantes dijeron a Garrison que Clay Bertrand también había sido visto por las oficinas de Guy Bannister junto con Oswald y Ferry. Sabiendo que Ferry mintió al decir que conoció a Oswald patinando en Houston, Garrison comenzó secretamente su investigación.
We started digging into Oswald's background, his acquaintances, found he was being used and manipulated for some reason, dug back into those witnesses, and ultimately found ourselves dancing with the Central Intelligence Agency.
Jim went into what I call a tirade about the CIA killing our president. And I had heard this so many times, and I was tired from my trip to Houston. And I really didn't know anything else to say, and I wanted to go home. And I just said, in a down way, I said, Jim, if the CIA killed the president, there's nothing a chicken shit assistant DA from New Orleans is going to be able to do about it. And sort of resigned that I was probably going to get fired for that comment. And he started laughing in his wonderful laugh, and then looked at me and said, there's probably nothing a chicken shit DA is going to be able to do about it either.
I thought, you know, like most investigations, you know, within a couple of months, it'll come to a conclusion. I never figured it would mushroom the way it did.
En el juicio a Clay Bertrand, hubo testigos que declararon que su descripción se ajustaba a la de Clay Shaw. Clay Shaw era presidente de la Trademark International y uno de los ciudadanos más prominentes de New Orleans. Con evidencia de que Oswald y Ferry eran socios y que Shaw podría ser el misterioso Clay Bertrand, Garrison estaba por elevar su investigación cuando la historia inesperadamente se desmoronó el 17 de febrero de 1967.
There's no question in my mind but what there will be in time arrests of individuals following our investigation. And there is no question in my mind but what in time to come, there will be charges and there will be convictions based on the charges.
David Ferry llamó a la prensa para confirmar que Garrison lo había estado interrogando. Luego llamó a Lou Ibon.
Dave called my house, and my wife answered the phone and wanted to talk to me. And he's highly excited, you know, he's got on the phone with him, and he's scared for his life.
I told them about a summer of 63 that I had gone up to Dave Ferry's apartment, which was Louisiana.
Considerando las historias sobre Ferry y la conspiración de asesinato, se presentó un joven vendedor de seguros, Perry Russo, quien se convertiría en el testigo clave de Garrison.
Ferry was in control of the gathering, and he was in one of his obsessive evenings concerning his hatred of the President of the United States.
Russo le dijo a Garrison que había escuchado a Ferry, Oswald, a algunos cubanos y a Clay Bertrand discutir sobre un complot para asesinar al presidente Kennedy. Russo dijo que se presentó porque estuvo allí casualmente y no deseaba ser implicado en la investigación de Garrison. Luego Russo señaló una fotografía de Clay Bertrand. Era Clay Shaw.
Shaw was introduced to me as Bertrand.
A una semana de la primera historia, la oficina de Garrison recibió la última llamada de David Ferry.
So they just hold still. I'll be right over. I got hold of Jim. And we made arrangements to put him in the old Fontainebleau.
Lou Ibon se quedó con Ferry en el Fontainebleau hasta la mañana temprano. Ferry le confió que él, Oswald, Bannister y Clay Shaw eran de la CIA. Lou dejó a Ferry como a las 4 de la mañana.
And then, of course, the next thing we found, we got a call that he was dead in his apartment on Louisiana Avenue.
And it reads as follows: to leave this life is for me a sweet prospect.
Ferry dejó cartas de suicidio tipeadas. Con la muerte de Ferry, Garrison sintió que debía moverse rápidamente para arrestar a Shaw. De otro modo, tal vez encontraría más cartas de suicidio. El primero de marzo del 67, Clay Shaw fue tomado en custodia por conspirador en el asesinato del presidente John F. Kennedy.
There were marble statues of penises on his dresser. There were whips and chains in his closet. And there were hooks and beams with handprints next to them. And there were also leather straps in his bedroom that could very conceivably be used to tie a person's hands to those hooks. What they were looking for was any documents that would link these parties together.
En la agenda de Shaw, Garrison encontró el número de un apartado postal que correspondía con uno de la agenda de Oswald. Cuando Clay Shaw fue fichado el primero de marzo del 67, nadie fuera de la oficina de Garrison sabía que también buscaban a Clay Bertrand.
Never released to the public. Nobody knew that, and no police officer knew about a Clay Bertrand.
Lou Ibon dijo que cuando Clay Shaw fue fichado y sus huellas fueron tomadas, el oficial a cargo le preguntó de rutina si usaba algún alias. Clay Shaw dijo, sí, Clay Bertrand.
Shaw was one of the secret supervisors of Oswald.
Garrison dijo que Shaw estaba ayudando a crear una identidad para Oswald, quien se convertiría en el títere perfecto.
Not only did we not have the cooperation of the federal government, but in fact, they were the enemy. And we had 12 assistant DAs, I believe, and maybe about 10 investigators. No agency, law enforcement agency was cooperating with us, even our own police department.
He called me and said, you know about my situation, you know what I'm doing down here, and I said, yes, I do. And he said, would you come down and just take a look at us, at what we're doing down here? And I said, sure. And I had a one-year lease for this place at Stanford University. I canceled it in 15 minutes.
Bajo la ley de Luisiana, Jim Garrison pudo haber acusado a Shaw por sí solo, pero para asegurarle al público que estaba respetando sus derechos y los de su propio puesto en caso de apelación, Garrison llevó a Shaw ante el gran jurado. El gran jurado escuchó las evidencias y procedió a acusarlo.
He went through a grand jury, but I have to say it was a grand jury that he had in his pocket.
Para asegurar la veracidad de su caso y proteger los derechos de Clay Shaw, Garrison pidió una audiencia preliminar ante el panel de tres jueces. La defensa de Shaw intentó introducir al informe Warren como evidencia. Los jueces se rehusaron.
I'm the lawyer who tried to introduce it, and that is accurate.
La acusación del gran jurado contra Clay Shaw fue rápida. Llevarlo a la corte demoró 2 años.
The news media's reaction to Garrison, I attributed to their feelings towards Shaw initially. But then it became directed in a very bitter fashion towards Garrison, as though he were, there was something sinister about Jim Garrison, something dangerously sinister.
They think our efforts to objectify our witness are something sinister, when we just don't have time to fool with it. So we give lie detectors now to witnesses we think are lying.
De Washington vino una sorprendente declaración del fiscal general diciendo que Clay Shaw ya había sido absuelto por el Departamento de Justicia de toda participación en el asesinato. Ya que el nombre de Shaw no había aparecido en el informe Warren, algunos periodistas preguntaron por qué Shaw fue investigado en primer lugar. El fiscal general, dijo un ayudante, había estado en un error.
They had substantial data by that time because we had that Clay Shaw, for example, had been with the Central Intelligence Agency ever since he was with the Mississippi River Shipping Company.
Antes del juicio a Shaw, Garrison avanzó en el caso al acusarse al abogado Dean Andrews de perjurio por mentir al gran jurado, diciendo que Clay Shaw no era Clay Bertrand.
And that was a very important conviction, but that's never mentioned.
We got no help from the FBI on or any records that we were trying to get, investigative records, which ordinarily we would have gotten. Got no help at all.
Garrison would have gladly stepped back and turned everything he had, including manpower, over to any legitimate federal authority that wanted to continue that investigation.
Documentos del FBI revelaron que Bill Alford tenía razón. El columnista Jack Anderson, actuando como contacto de la agencia, vino desde New Orleans convencido de que Garrison tenía un caso que había ofrecido a la agencia. El FBI lo rechazó.
In the preparation for the trial of Clay Shaw by the district attorney's office, was the feeling in the district attorney's office that the case would never get to trial anyway.
Either because of his death or for some other reason.
They had two men assigned to Jim around the clock when all these threats were coming from morning till night.
We were a close family, and my mother made sure that even though they had policemen and they would bring us to school and all, it wasn't any scary situation or anything, because we were a close family.
We used to kind of play with the
police
officer. He's more of a companion.
Yeah, it was great.
Then, you know, kind of a sign that something was wrong or we should be worried about something.
Yeah, it's just one of those things where you grow up that way, that's the way you think. It doesn't seem that peculiar or different.
When you got bored playing with one of the other kids, they had this adult who was there, or so we thought, to entertain us, not to protect us.
One day, Mom decided, I guess, to get us all out of the house and said that we were going to go to the store because she was going to bake a cake. And on the way there, I guess in the rearview mirror, she picked up that an FBI car had picked her up, and so she kind of made it like a game. She was trying to lose them, but every corner we turned, they turned. It was like, losing, Mom, losing, but I don't think she ever did.
I'm not a person inclined to be unduly fearful, but if somebody is removed, as I am, from the, normally, from the reach of people in the killing business, if I reached the point of where I was concerned about the possibility of that happening, you can just visualize the concern of people at a less protected level.
I was digging up some information, actually, for Jim Garrison and Penn Jones Jr. of Midlothian. I was digging up some information that they wanted, you know, in Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
And I parked my car on the side of the street, and I went to get this information. And when I came back and cranked up my car, it blew up.
El ex oficial de policía de Dallas, Roger Craig, fue hospitalizado por 2 meses. Luego cometió suicidio con un rifle.
I don't like to go into that because they have families and everything else, but we lost a few witnesses by physical reasons, just like Dallas did.
Anybody that would approach him, he would bring him on board. And he was one of our biggest security leaks in the office. Jim himself, you know, it's sad to say, without him knowing it.
one man, as I remarked recently to Mark Lane, had me wondering why he always carried such a large briefcase. And it was almost as big as a suitcase. And I realize now the reason he was carrying such a large briefcase was he could take home more of our documents every day.
We had people, it was brought aboard that later on that we found that they wasn't working for the interest of the investigation or for Jim. You know, and I'm talking about people that were giving our records away.
If they can't remove you, and they do assassinate in the United States, and they've been doing it for years, and I'm sure they still do, because there's no reason for them to change their policies. Now they've been continually successful. If they can't kill you, they concentrate on discreditation.
En junio del 67, la NBC Noticias divulgó papeles blancos, intentando desacreditar el caso de Jim Garrison y su testigo.
Can you say positively that the person you knew as Clay Bertram is not the person you have seen as Clay Shaw?
Scott's honor, he is not.
In my conversations with Perry Russo, he has stated that his testimony against Clay Shaw may be a combination of truth, fantasy, and lies.
He was not investigating any facts. His only purpose was, and he stated it pointedly, he said, I'm going to take Garrison out of this. He says, you're going down with him. He says, if you want to go, he says, you go with him because he says, you're finished. He says, now there is a way out. And I said, what would that be? He said, you go over to Biloxi, Mississippi. He said, we have a motel over there. He says, you're to walk in the motel. Clay Shaw will be in there, and you're to walk out and state on television that you do not know Clay Shaw, you have never seen him, and that he was never up in...
Siendo desconocido por el investigador de la NBC, Walter Sheridan, Perry Russo había grabado su conversación para Jim Garrison.
You're to state that Oswald was never at Dave Ferry's apartment. And number four is you know nothing about any Kennedy plotters or any plot to kill the president of the United States. And I said, if I do that, what do you suppose would happen to me in New Orleans?
Perry Russo is an amazing witness. You have to remember that the defense and the federal government and anyone interested in destroying Jim Garrison's case had 2 years to work on Perry Raymond Russo.
So I said, I wouldn't be able to even live in New Orleans. He says, what state are you interested in living in? And I was caught off guard by this, and so I said, I've always been interested in California. He said, what city? I said, I don't know. L.A., Los Angeles. I said, it's always been the city of dreams.
They worked on one of our main witnesses, Perry Russo, offered him a job in an insurance company in California.
I didn't go to Biloxi because what Walter Sheridan was asking me to do was an absolute lie. Shaw was there, Ferry was there, Oswald was there. Garrison, subsequent to this, indicted him for tampering and obstructing justice. Of course, that indictment fell in federal court. He never went to trial.
They didn't want to just discredit Jim Garrison. They wanted him destroyed.
What's that? You say that you are an American citizen and you want to see the autopsy x-rays and you want to see these hundreds of documents that have been...
La Comisión Federal de Comunicaciones encontró los papeles blancos de la NBC tergiversados y ordenó dar a Garrison media hora para responder.
Can't you take the word of these honorable men who've looked into it for you?
Ante la aparición del escritor satírico Mort Sahl en el Tonight Show, Garrison fue visto otra vez en la NBC.
So then he came out and he said, what are you doing these days, Mort? And Mort said, I'm an investigator for Jim Garrison. Oh, really? I mean, he was floored, although he just heard that 2 hours before. And he said, yeah. And then he said, we've uncovered a lot of interesting things. Johnny, why don't you ever have Jim Garrison as a guest on the show? At that point, there was an ovation from the audience. And Johnny sort of quieted him down and said, well, I'd like to if they will allow me to do that.
Como algunas veces Garrison era impaciente o irreverente con la prensa, Mark Lane y Mort Sahl decidieron que ensayara.
Mort and I will be Johnny Carson. We'll ask you the tough questions. And you just remain really calm. He said, I can do that, Mark. I said, okay, fine. Is it true you got a mental discharge from the Air Force? Those fucking guys, I looked at the fucking question, got up and started running around the room. I said, well, this is the problem, gentlemen. So we went over and over. And then he felt he was prepared. He had a lot easier job preparing Jim than they had preparing Johnny. Jim won the day, and Jim got tremendous applause from the audience, obviously, and was the first time that the American people heard that kind of an allegation made on network television.
El 29 de enero del 69, casi dos años después de su arresto, Clay Shaw fue a juicio por conspiración en el asesinato del presidente John F. Kennedy.
We knew he would commit perjury. While we felt we would win the first case, we knew that he had to lie about his associations with Oswald and Ferry, and that's where we had our strongest witnesses.
Garrison intentó hacer comparecer a Allen Dulles y Richard Helms de la CIA para interrogarlo sobre la relación de Oswald y Shaw con la agencia. Oficiales federales se negaron a ello, y solo con otro citatorio pudo Garrison obtener la película de Abraham Zapruder. Por primera vez sería vista por un jurado de ciudadanos americanos.
Any intelligent person, even a child, has to do is look this through the film. After the shot hits him in the head, the critical shot, John Kennedy goes backwards towards the back of the car. So he's almost blown out of the back of the car. John Kennedy was obviously shot from the front. Everybody knows it, and especially the government.
There was a great feeling of depression among the news media. I'm talking about the established news media, because Garrison had pierced the bubble of which the news media had encased the case in.
A pesar de lo convincente que era la película y de la credibilidad de los testigos de Garrison, uno de ellos le echó a perder el caso, Charles Spiezel.
The question I posed to Jimmy is, didn't anyone talk to this guy before you put him on the stand?
An accountant in New York City who had said that he had met Shaw and Oswald at a party.
We had no idea that he had this sort of background or would admit to this sort of background.
On cross-examination, this accountant testified that when his daughter came back to him from Louisiana, instead of saying, "Hello, darling," he brought her into the room in his apartment and fingerprinted her, and then checked the fingerprints against those on file to make sure it was really his own daughter and that the government had not substituted a duplicate for her. The jury heard this, and this was the end.
I have always felt that he was one of those plants.
The case had been destroyed by calling that one witness. I did go to the Hall of Records in Louisiana and found out that that building had, at the time this gentleman said he met Shaw and Oswald there, been owned by Clay Shaw.
Otra sorpresa fue que el juez Haggerty no permitió al oficial de registros testificar que mientras estaba fichando a Clay Shaw, este dijo que su alias era Clay Bertrand. El primero de marzo de 1969, el jurado absolvió a Clay Shaw. Encuestados después, la mayoría de los miembros del jurado admitió que hubo una conspiración para asesinar a Kennedy, pero que hubo poca evidencia para vincular a Clay Shaw con ella. Como Shaw había negado bajo juramento conocer tanto a Oswald como a Ferry, Garrison lo acusó de perjurio.
In a move which is, I still think, highly illegal and probably unprecedented, the local federal courts gave an order that we could not prosecute him. Reasons are still obscure, but they blocked the prosecution, and it would have been an absolute certainty of conviction.
We think of the Scopes case today as a great victory. Clarence Darrow lost that case.
Pocos años después del juicio, surgió una fotografía que mostraba tres hombres en una fiesta que fueron identificados como David Ferry, Clay Shaw, y Lee Harvey Oswald.
If you had it to do over again, would you launch another investigation?
Yes, I would have to, because once you know that something was hidden, once you know what happened, then you have no choice.
La prensa y los dirigentes pidieron la renuncia de Garrison. Los votantes lo reeligieron. Estando aún Garrison en posición de procesar el caso, el gobierno lo procesó a él.
We were hounded, harassed by a variety of government assets and agencies. The FBI, for example.
He was prosecuted himself on two separate occasions after the trial of Clay Shaw. Once he was charged with accepting a bribe. In essence, he not only won that case and was totally exonerated, but it was nevertheless the springboard for the next case, which basically was that he failed to report income tax on the bribe, which he had never received, and he won that case as well.
El increíble estrés de los pasados dos años acentuó los problemas de su matrimonio. Jim y su esposa Liz se divorciaron.
There were pressures that my wife felt, and so each one of us had to end up being an entirely different person, although she was relatively easy to live with, a very sweet person. So, but I think it was a weight on the scale, certainly.
My mother has always wanted just a close family, you know, a normal family life for her kids, and there was no way that a normal family could exist in that situation, but I'm sure it put a lot of pressure on it. But as to say that that was the exact or the only reason, I don't know.
Demasiado ocupado defendiéndose a sí mismo para funcionar eficientemente como fiscal, Garrison perdió en su tercera elección. Se dedicó durante cuatro años a la práctica privada, escribió una novela y ganó una elección de la Cámara de Apelaciones. En su segundo término, no tenía oposición.
And I realized I was suddenly an object of interest to the agency. I guess I might have assumed that earlier, but it didn't occur to me. I guess part of me still thought I was living in the country I was born in. So the conclusion I would give you was they did everything they could to tear the office apart, to tear the trial apart. And they did tear the trial apart, but the time came when I was no longer district attorney. Whatever their explicit objectives were, they accomplished them, but I would have to reply. On the other hand, the agency, when it was all over, they knew they'd been danced with.
Epílogo. El 18 de julio de 1979, el comité de la Cámara concluyó que hubo conspiración para asesinar al presidente John F. Kennedy y Martin Luther King. La conclusión del comité de la Cámara finalmente reivindicó a Jim Garrison y a los demás críticos del informe Warren. Jim Garrison, que se retiró del cargo en octubre de 1991, poco antes de cumplir 70 años, pudo encontrar mayor reconocimiento en Hollywood que en Washington. Oliver Stone hizo JFK basado en parte en la investigación de Jim Garrison y el proceso a Clay Shaw. A pesar de las falencias que pudiera tener la película, esta aportó al pueblo una perspectiva del asesinato no explorada por la prensa nacional. También brindó consuelo y esperanza a los hijos de Garrison.
There's so much criticism of it because they're saying it distorts history, but what's the alternative? Except the Warren Commission is history. I hope it succeeds in at least letting people know that something wasn't right and they should be more skeptical of what their government tells them and what they read in the papers.
I wish I could say in heroic words that yes, I would do it again. But actually, what the investigation cost me, a magnificent office which took years to build up, and a tremendous amount of emotional involvement, not unrelated to my personal concern about what happened to John Kennedy and what was obviously happening to America. I'd say that I don't know if I would do it again because of the emotional price I paid.
J. Jim Garrison dijo que jamás se sintió como un héroe. Siendo el fiscal, era su trabajo. Los verdaderos héroes son los ciudadanos americanos que, en defensa de sus creencias, pusieron en peligro sus empleos e incluso sus vidas. Como escritor, Jim Garrison dijo que la verdadera ironía de esta tragedia americana es que para una nación que ahora solo quiere oír la verdad acerca del asesinato de Kennedy, el único testigo sobreviviente que vio dos hombres detrás de la cerca de la colina sea un sordo mudo. Subtitulado y doblado al español en video dub. Buenos Aires, Argentina.